Well, hey y'all. Welcome to the North Texas Teen Book Festival, the virtual festival. Usually this takes place in Irving, Texas, but for obvious reasons, we're going virtual this year, which I think is great because I hope that means more of you can join us from all over the place. Please, please spread your love for this wonderful festival using the hashtag NTTBF21. And I'll kick things off. So I'm Sarah Pitre. I'm the founder of a website for YA fans who are a little more A. It's called Forever Young Adult. And I'm really, really happy to be here with these incredible authors. So before we dig in, I wanna give them a chance to introduce themselves to you guys, talk a little bit about their books, and then we'll go from there. So I'm just gonna go based on my screen layout. Becky, I'm going to start with you. Would you like to introduce yourself to everyone?
Yeah, I'm Becky Albertalli, and I am best known for writing Simon versus the Homo Sapiens Agenda, which was adapted into the film Love, Simon in 2018.
Yay!
but today, I'm really excited to be talking about my upcoming book, Kate in Waiting, which doesn't come out until April 20th, but is something that I've been just dying to babble about for a very long time.
And we can't wait to talk about it. I'm excited. All right, thanks, Becky. Julie, let's cut to you next.
Yeah, I'm so excited to be here virtually. I think at first when we started doing all these virtual events, I was just like, this is silly, this is ridiculous. But now I'm just genuinely excited to see people I know, even if it's just on a computer screen. So I'm really excited to be here. I'm probably most well known for Dumplin', which was adapted into a Netflix movie in 20 something. He was so precise. I don't have that gift. This year I've got three books coming out, so it's a big year in
Julie. You've been doing nothing, Julie. Nothing.
Not a thing.
Really?
So, yeah. Exciting stuff. The first one coming out. Oh, right. That'll be Pumpkin coming out in May. That's the first one on the deck.
I'm excited to talk about that as well. Awesome. Thank you, Julie. Let's go to Anna Marie McLemore. Hello.
Hi, I'm so excited to be here. My name is Anna Marie McLemore. My pronouns are they, them. And I've written many queer, Latinx, trans, non-binary fairy tales, including Wild Beauty, Blanca y Roja, and most recently, Dark and Deepest Red. And the book that I am very excited to be here to talk about with Tehlor, Miss Meteor.
Huzzah, huzzah. Oh man, I can't wait to dig into this. So let's cut to Tehlor, your co-author.
Yeah, hi, Tehlor K. Mejia. I did my first North Texas Teen in 2019 and it was so fun, and I'm like both bummed not to be there and excited that we get to do it this way, because I, like Julie, miss seeing faces of people that don't live in my house. I'm the author of We Set the Dark on Fire, which is a queer Latinx dystopian fantasy, and yeah, as Anna Marie said, co-author of Miss Meteor.
Love it, love it. All right, and last but not least, we've got Mark Crilley. Hello.
Hi, thanks so much for having me here. It's such a thrill to be part of this. This is my first time being at the festival, and I really am glad to be able to take part in this panel. I started out in comics back in the 90s. And I briefly did some young reader novels, and then the comics pulled me back in. And I've really been doing graphic novels for the last 5 or 10 years. And my latest one is called My Last Summer with Cass. And it was a big deal for me because it's the first book I've ever done with swearing.
Whoa!
Stand back, everybody. So anyway, yeah, I'm really thrilled to be able to talk about it a little today.
Oh, that's great. I have to point out, I don't know, Becky, where your screen is, but you're right next to me and our walls are like the same color. It's like really distracting me. Like, are we in the same place? kind of cool. All right. So for those of you tuning in, I hope you know, but the name of this panel is In the Spotlight, which I think is really interesting. And normally I don't spend too much time like delving into just the name, but I think what piqued my interest about the name is that while it does make sense for y'all's books, there's beauty pageants, there's prom, running for prom court, there's, you know, literal high school musicals where people are, you know, physically in the spotlight. A lot of the characters in your books are in a way like not wanting to be in the spotlight. And like I when I was reading Miss Meteor, this quote that you guys wrote said, in a town this small for girls like us, survival is based mostly on how well you can camouflage. And so I kind of want to keep that theme in mind as we delve into some questions in terms of, you know, teenagers that are trying to find themselves, but might not want to share their true selves with the public or with people close to them even. I did also though want to point out that Becky, in the first chapter of your book, there's a great joke about Kate, the main character, says, "My brother said once that theater kids walk around like we're each under our own tiny spotlight. Pretty sure it wasn't a compliment." Which I love.
That's so real. Yeah.
Such a great contrast. So Julie, let me start with you. And then obviously any of y'all feel free to jump in as we go along. So can you talk about, you know, and you've done this in several, if not all of your books, writing that journey of self-discovery and self-love and sort of overcoming the fear of rejection, or even worse, for a fictional character. Like, when you know that there are so many teens out there wrestling with this in real life, how does that affect how you write, or does it affect how you write at all?
I think that, like, as a writer, I have to, like, work in a very fragile bubble. Like, I still have to be, like, very cognizant and aware of the world around me and affected by it, but I also have to be willing to exist, like, you know, in my own bubble and on my own. So it's been easier this year because we're all existing in our own bubble. But I really, you know, so Pumpkin is about this fat male identifying person named Waylon, and he is obsessed with this drag show. It's a fictional drag show, but I'm sure you can guess what drag show it might be inspired by. And it's recently been like the season finale of it. And he's got his heart set on this fat drag queen winning. And it's very obvious that this fat drag queen is the most talented and deserving one there. And then they don't win. And so Waylon has like this moment where he realizes that he has identified with this drag queen more than he ever thought possible and more than he knew. And he is feeling just as rejected as this drag queen, and really takes this drag queen's loss as sort of like a personal affront, as though like he didn't win, he wasn't deserving. So I think that the most interesting part of getting to write about fat people discovering themselves and discovering respect and love for themselves has been getting to discover how to do that in new ways. So I think that getting to, like, I think like figure out how to do that through like the scape of like a reality TV show competition, like, was so real to me. Cause I remember like one year there was a plus size contestant on Project Runway and I was obsessed with her. And all I wanted was to see her win and to see her succeed. And it felt like her success was my success. And so Waylon takes this moment and is able to transform it into like a personal journey that lasts for an entire book. But it's this thing that happens at the forefront of the book that really sticks with him and sculpts him in a way that he doesn't expect to find. And I think that a lot of us have found that with like these ridiculous reality TV show competitions that for most people feel like bubblegum pop culture and a waste of time, but we're really finding ourselves represented in ways that we didn't expect to find. So I don't know if that answers the question, but that's what I said.
That's for me. Does anyone have anything to add to that, or?
Mostly just that I deeply relate to having kind of lost myself in reality TV in high school because I didn't have like a ton of friends or a big social group. And I remember watching the first season of American Idol. I'm like dating myself, but just being like obsessed with these people, like they're real people, like they're, these are my friends, and getting so emotionally invested. So that like very much resonates for me, Jory.
My well, reality TV was like Real World Road Rules Challenges, so I think I've dated myself even further.
Well, but what's interesting about that is like they are real people.
Yeah.
In terms of, you know, more real than a character in a movie. But yet obviously they're not maybe 100% real in terms of how they would be not on the show.
It's really bizarre, like especially as I actually have two books this year that have to do with a reality TV show in some sort of sense, and this book is much more minor in dealing with that, but I've gotten the chance to like meet people who have been on reality TV shows and are like recurring people on reality TV shows that like keep coming back for like challenges or different things like that, and it's like they're still them on those shows, like now that I know them as people, they're just like very elevated versions of themselves. And like very produced and orchestrated versions of themselves.
Yeah, that's true. I feel like we could have a whole panel about reality TV, but that's not what this is about. So we're going to keep going, even though I do want to talk more about it. So Becky, here's a question for you. I read an interview with you recently where you talked about how you feel like the pandemic, you know, obviously it's isolating for everyone, but, you know, thinking about teens that are, you know, identify as LGBTQ, that it's especially isolating for them. How do you, you know, when you think about that, obviously it means that books can be, just like reality TV, books can be a way for them to connect or not feel quite as alone. And does that sort of feed into your writing process? Like similar to my question to Julie, like does that kind of affect the journey that you're writing for your characters?
In a sense, I mean, I definitely did not, at the time that I wrote Kate, I did not know about COVID in our future. But, and that is kind of, that is introduced, you know, so many new elements to, you know, just what day-to-day life is like, you know, for different various teens in various communities. And it's, you know, it's certainly something that has always, you know, been on my mind as I've written for this particular audience, you know, and when I think about that, I think about the fact that, you know, my books, you know, maybe landing in a home where, like, you know, the parents cannot find out that the stories are queer, you know, or sometimes the kids do not have access to my books at all. There have been times I used to, this has been something that unfortunately I haven't been able to do as my audience has gotten bigger, but in the beginning there were a couple times when I like would go to used bookstores and find books that were the same size as Simon, and put the jacket on Simon, and send it, you know, to my giveaway winner or
that's awesome,
whichever kid, yeah, well, you know, just could not bring, you know, my book with its particular cover blurb into their home. And, you know, that is an ongoing problem for some, but not all. I'm getting like a pop up there, but some, but not all teens. Like, of course, there's not any universal experience, even for kids who on paper maybe seem like they would have very similar experiences, but you know, it's something I always try to be mindful of, and I think, you know, our readers aren't just in the US, and you know, the landscape can look really different in other countries and in other parts of this country and in other houses in your own neighborhood, you know? So, yeah, so I guess the things that I think about are, and you can't control all of this, but accessibility and trying to, just be as authentic as I can be, both in the stories and in like the way I interact on social media to the best of my abilities.
Yeah. Yeah. Thank you. Semi-related, this question's for Anna Marie and Tehlor. I read another interview with you guys where you talked about the importance of marginalized teens seeing themselves in stories with fun settings, stories with happy endings. And I mean, there's so much of Miss Meteor that is such a blast. It's so much fun, but you still dig deep into, you know, some pretty emotional territory, even some traumatic territory. So can you guys talk about striking that balance and keeping your stories, you know, authentic, but still infusing them with joy and with hope?
Yeah. Do you mind if I go first?
No, go for it.
I think it was something we talked about a lot early on, because we both, if you've read either of our solo books, are a little bit more, we trend a little darker than we did in this book. My books are definitely very, very angsty, I know. So I think we were both sort of like, we wanted to see something fun. And at first we were like, what if we just write something that's fluff? Like, we just want to write like pure fun fluff. But as we were digging into it, it was like, no, the important thing really is to show that there's a real life contrast, because I think both all positive stories that ignore the effects of marginalization on, you know, disenfranchised kids and kids from marginalized groups can feel alienating, because it's like, it's a fun wish fulfillment, but it's not, it's never going to be real. So it's something that's a little bit hard to lose yourself in, for me anyway. But then books that are all struggle are kind of like, well, okay, but, you know, like, we have fun too. So I think it's important to show that not only do those things both exist in like our cultures and our communities, but they kind of feed into each other in this really beautiful way that was important to us while we were writing. Like, sometimes you enjoy the fun more because you have to struggle, and sometimes you're able to endure the struggle better because you have the joy. So it all kind of is intermixed, and if you try to focus only on one or the other, you lose that balance.
Definitely.
Yeah, and you're going to be able to have some of that fun and some of those adventures and that joy. You're going to be able to have that more easily when you're around people who understand you. And that's a lot of what this book is about. This whole group of friends, all four of them, but especially these two girls at the heart of this book, who just get things about each other. There's a lot that they talk about, but even more, there's a lot that they don't talk about. And some of that comes in the book. Like, they're going to have to talk about it, but some of the power of it is what can go unspoken, like the things that they just know about each other, the common shared experiences. And as I was thinking about, as Tehlor was talking about the process of writing this, in a way, the hard things that we talk about in this book, they had to go alongside things that were funny, alongside things that were fun. We're talking about racism, we're talking about colorism, queerphobia, transphobia. And you have to, sometimes you have to have those things alongside things that are fun and things that are gonna make you laugh, both for the reader and for these characters to be able to sort of take this journey and take this in. I've been thinking about this and talking about this. I have a book that comes out on March 16th called The Mirror Season, that's about sexual assault and survivors like supporting each other and finding each other. And there's a lot of humor in that book, and there kind of had to be to write that. And I don't think I would have been ready to write that if we hadn't written Miss Meteor and had all of these like these antics going alongside these characters really, really just understanding their own pain and understanding each other.
Yeah. I feel the same way. I made the jump right to a book about drug addiction. So I feel the same way. I was like, this is a really tough subject for me to tackle, but because we got to do it together and like sort of, it's a book about these girls doing this tough thing with each other's support, and we were also doing a tough thing with each other's support, which was really cool. So I definitely felt more capable of going out and writing a super heavy book after this too. So thank you.
Yeah, and I mean, obviously, as y'all said, the friendship is so central to the book, and yet it's, you know, it's a complicated relationship. And I want to get more into that overall, but Mark, I'll move on to you, because your book is also about a friendship between two different teen girls. So how did you go about like establishing their friendship or crafting it, in terms of how did that go along with the art in the book? Can you walk us through that process?
Okay, wonderful. Well, this book had a sort of an interesting genesis in my own obsession with creativity, creative people, and how they seem to fall into two different types. To me, there's the sort of authentic artist who really tells their truth, even if it means, you know, possibly offending somebody, but they got to be true to who they are. And then there's another type of artist that's a little more of like a show person, right? Who's really a people pleaser, and they're eager to entertain. And that's kind of me, really. And I even had a friend in high school, and we're still friends up until now, who was more of that authentic artist type. And I kept thinking, can I come up with a story that allows me to sort of present this? And what happens when these two different types of artists come together? And, you know, there's a friendship there, but they can maybe come into conflict because of these different instincts. And that's really what gave birth to these two characters. Megan, who's the narrator, is really based more or less on me. And then Cass, who is her friend, who's this more sort of authentic, you know, I compare it to like Lennon and McCartney, right? John Lennon was a little more thorny, right? And difficult sometimes. And Paul McCartney was the sort of easygoing, you know, possibly less authentic in a way, right? And so these two characters, Cass becomes that more John Lennon-like rebel character. And it was really fun sort of imagining, you know, taking this slightly autobiographical thing, but then putting it into two other characters and letting them kind of come alive and become different people for me and my friend.
Yeah, and I think one of the things I feel like I'm noticing a little bit more nowadays in the YA sphere is there seem to be more and more books that delve into the evolution of friendships. I feel like back in the day, I don't know, like 10 years ago, there were obviously tons of books about romantic breakups, and not as many books about, you know, friendship breakups or you know, friendship conflicts. And obviously that's super common when you're growing up. And it's just not something I think, you know, especially remembering like when I was a kid, like I wasn't prepared for that because I'd never really seen a friendship breakup portrayed right in a movie or a book or something. And so Becky, going back to you, you know, in your book, you've got these two best friends who both have a crush on the same boy. And so I feel like, you know, how are you tackling that evolution of adolescent friendship, like through that plot?
Yeah, so I would say the central premise of Kate Waiting is, you know, these two friends, Kate and Anderson, a guy and a girl, having a crush on the same boy is their thing, kind of. Like it's a hobby. They do it for, like, it's the crush is like not the point, that person, you know, you can just like plug somebody else in, because it's so much more about the kind of giddy, like, you know, like comparing secret notes and like, let me take a picture of you with that person in the background. Never did that. But it's, you know, always really been about the two of them and their friendship. And the book starts basically when one of their kind of very casual crushes ends up like, you know, this is somebody from camp, from summer camp, and he like moves to their hometown, starts going to their school, and then is a part of the like the theater club and like kind of school musical crowd that is like their home at school. So he is like right there, and he's kind of awesome, and they both actually like him now. And you know, and I think kind of the thing you know, throughout this story that I tried to hold on to was that and not lose sight of was that kind of, you know, for me, the love story in this book was always between these two friends, and that you know, was always central. And I am somebody who loves to write crushes and kissing, and I definitely took the opportunity to do that for sure. But I think it, I think it was, you know, it was fun to be able to live in that space and explore that with a very clear priority in my mind, that just, you know, for these two characters, like, you know, the first person is always each other.
Yeah. And Tehlor and Anna Marie, for y'all, can you speak to, I feel like in your book, you really are exploring what happens to a friendship when the two people in the friendship are really growing or evolving, or at least just sort of wrestling with their true selves. Can you speak to that?
Yeah. I think I always say this about high school friendships, that the books I wanted to read in high school were always the romance ones, because I had never experienced romance. Like, I was definitely not like the girl with the high school. I had crushes, but yeah, kind of like Becky was saying, like, the point was always to talk about them with your friends. The point wasn't to like, what are you gonna do, like, go talk to the person? Forget it.
No.
I feel like what was real to me, and so what I didn't really care to read about, was that all the intensity and all the drama and all the like heartbreak was happening in my friendships always, and that stuff was so real. And you know, between like, you have friends that you've known since fifth grade, obviously by high school you're going to be totally different people, and you don't know yet that people grow apart. So you're like, no, we're friends because we've always been friends. And at no other point in your life, I think, do you work that hard to keep your friends in the same place, because they're permanent to you, like that's where they're supposed to be. And so I think with Chicky and Lita and Miss Meteor, it's sort of like they've hit this wall where they would have probably continued to kind of like change their own shapes and make sacrifices to stay part of like in the same shape, but they've hit this wall of like, we can't, like who we are is physically coming up against like how we interact with each other, and we can't be honest with each other, so we can't be friends. And there's so much, I feel like, just real drama and heartache in finding at this point when you're supposed to stay together that you can't. And so like ultimately they do find a way to figure it out, but they have to grow into themselves so much more to feel comfortable being honest with each other, to sort of start this new friendship together. And I think all the people I know that I knew when I was a teenager, we're not still those friends, you know. You have to like become the people you're going to become comfortable being that person, be able to share that with the other person, and then start a new thing based on that. And so I think that's kind of what we wrote about with Chicky and Lita, was just the process of kind of distilling the person you're growing into to the point where you can share it with people you love.
Yeah,
I feel that so much. And I think with Chicky and Lita, there's a certain extent to which they sort of figure out that they're making themselves stay in that same shape more than the other person was ever asking them to. And it's completely understandable, especially with what Tehlor was talking about. Like, there's some stuff that they need to figure out before they can even talk about it, before they can even share it. But I think that moment where you figure out if a friendship is going to last is often when you come to that moment of, is is that other person going to ask you to stay that same person? Or was that more on your end? However understandable that might be. Like, I don't relate at all. Like, not knowing how to come out as trans or non-binary to like my friends. I don't relate at all to that. So that's something that was very, it's very special to me to read about Chickie's journey. So that them being able to move forward and them finding a kind of acceptance with each other that they had such a hard time getting to themselves. That's, I adore both of the romances in this book so much. I love them, but Chickie and Lita are like the love story of this book to me.
Yeah, they're my favorite. So good. Let me cut to a question from the audience. Julie, this question is for you. This is from Hope from Bowie Middle School. Can't wait to hear what you say to this, Julie. What is your work schedule like when you're writing?
I hope. Well, I'm always writing is the first answer. And the second answer is it's pretty chaotic. I wish that I've wanted for a very long time to be the writer who wakes up at 6 or 7 in the morning and has like avocado toast breakfast and like a chill morning, answers emails, checks the news, takes her dog for a walk, but I'm not that person. I get into a cycle where I start working until like 2 or 3 in the morning and then waking up at like 10:30 or 11 and then just like remembering how to be a person until like 2 or 3 in the afternoon and then working nonstop until something good comes on TV or Netflix and then taking a break and then going back to work. It's not a very healthy situation, but during like the times of COVID, it's not a big deal and it's worked out just fine for me. So I've really found myself like cementing myself in that schedule. But I mean, should I continue to strive to be the 7 a.m. person? I don't know, but I am. She exists in there somewhere. I still like avocado toast. I just eat it at like 11 p.m.
Anytime. all right. Well, this question is from Valeria from J. Frank Dobie. Becky, it's for you, but I think I also would love to hear Mark's response as well. So Valeria would like to know, Becky, who inspired you to start writing?
Thank you so much, Valeria. It's funny because I have always been writing. I'm guessing it was probably like my parents or my preschool teacher or something, technically, who, you know, and I have a whole collection of just like, some of these stories that I wrote and illustrated as a kid are like, pile them up and like hand them to my psychologist. Like, you know, they are revealing, but you know, but I think for a very long time I did not think that I could actually be an author. Like, that didn't seem like a real career path. Like, that was just, you know, it was like being an actor, which it turns out is like also a real job. But yeah, so it seemed very far away from my life. So I, you know, I had a whole other career. I became a psychologist. And, you know, it, I would say kind of the biggest influence, you know, on my writing and just as kind of when I think about, you know, an author's work that absolutely inspired me and was kind of a game changer for me would be Jacqueline Moriarty out in Australia, who I got to meet before COVID started. But that was like, you know, reading, particularly it was the year of Secret Assignments was the one that I read, and it floored me because it's funny and voicey. And it was like, I just didn't know you were allowed to write like that. I think I thought you had to write like, you know, just flowery literary kind of prose to be a real author and to be taken seriously. And so I think the seed was planted there. And it wasn't, you know, it took a minute for me to attempt to like write a full book, but I would say that's where it started.
Awesome. Mark, what about you?
Well, I was really lucky when I was in college. I had the great good fortune to have the mentor in the form of David Small, who is a great children's picture book writer and illustrator, if you're not familiar. During his last few years of teaching, I got to be among his last students. And of course, he was a huge inspiration in terms of art, but then I also saw that he was both writing and illustrating his books. One of his greatest books was published at that time, Imogene's Antlers, and I got to see all the original artwork. And I think that was where the light went off in my head. Boy, I can come up with stories, and I can also do the drawings, and I can do both of these jobs. But in a funny way, instead of going into children's picture books, I ended up going into comics. A fairly different thing, and yet there's a lot in common there. The you know, with picture books, you have the constant interaction between words and pictures, and you don't want one to be repeating the other too much, right? The words should not be simply telling you what the pictures are. The words are doing one thing, and there's this interplay between the two. And so, yeah, I think I was lucky to have David Small as that initial inspiration, because it really dovetailed nicely with my future interest in creating comics.
Yeah, that's so cool. All right, our last audience question is from Devika from Jasper High School, and it's for Anna Marie and Tehlor. Devika wants to know, how do you build up your characters? Do you plan their personalities and individual trajectories in advance, or do you let them develop naturally as you write?
This is a really interesting question for Ms. Meteor, because this was a process where we talked about these characters and this town for what was it? It was months, wasn't it? Yeah, and that which was really interesting considering how fast we ended up drafting the book. But I think part of it was just the going back and forth of like talking about these characters, talking about their world. And then as we were trading chapters back and forth, I think that's how, at least for me, that's a lot of how I went deeper and deeper into Lita, was learning more about Chicky, learning more about Chicky's sisters, who are Lita's pageant coaches.
I love her sisters so much. Oh man, I love them, but I'm scared of them. I don't know.
That's exactly how you're supposed to feel. Yeah, no, I totally agree. We have like these probably just long text conversations that are like, Anna Marie will be like, oh, and then Lita would say this, and I'll be like, oh yeah, and then Chicky would say this. And so I think we got like such a strong sense of who they were as people just by having fun like talking about who they were, that once it was time for them to like interact with the story, it was really easy to see how they would respond to different things, because by then we already knew them so well, which is funny because that's really different than how I normally do characters, and it was like way easier and more fun. So going back to having to do it by myself was kind of lame after that. I was like, oh man. I wish we could just develop characters together all the time.
Hey, you guys should write another book together, why not?
We'll see. We have to have two of our ideas find each other again, because that was how this happened. Is we both realized that we each had half of a book, and yeah, they needed to go together to make a whole book.
If it happens again, though, I would be down.
Fingers crossed. All right, let's do some lightning round questions. I'll call on you, so you have to answer. But so you know when it's your turn. The first one is, in honor of Miss Meteor, if you were competing in a pageant, what would your talent be? And no, writing and Mark for you also drawing, et cetera, are not options for this pageant. So I'll give you a second. What would your talent be? I'll start with Julie.
I've also written a pageant book, so I've thought about this many times, I've been asked this many times, and I know my answer. My talent would be online shopping. And I know that sounds a little ridiculous, but you know how there are those like browser plugins you can add that will tell you like the best code or the best deal that you can get at the specific website. I'm the human version of that. So that would be my talent.
I will give you a good score for that. Yeah. Anne-Marie, what about you?
Oh, definitely Irish dancing. I'm currently learning to play the tin whistle, so I'm going to try to make it next, like Irish dancing while playing the tin whistle.
Oh my, okay, yes, please.
No bicycles involved though, just Taylor, just so you know.
That's good, I think we all learned from that experience. That's awesome, wow, okay. Yeah, you get like, what is it, 10 out of 10? How do they score pageants? I don't know, you guys tell me.
Or she gets 10 out of 10.
Oh wow.
I give you a wave of my wand for that terrible, wonderful pun.
Unplug my computer. I'm done.
Becky, what about you?
I can do it right here. I can touch my tongue to my nose.
What?
Oh. Wow. That's amazing.
Okay.
Judge Scorpion.
That's it.
This question's panning out better than I thought it would. All right, Taylor, what about you?
Okay, I used to do, it'll probably end in disaster because I haven't done it in a really long time, but when I was younger, I used to do this, like, it's like Hawaiian, like, fire dancing where you spin these, like, wicks on chains, but they're on fire, and you make shapes with them, and me and my sister weirdly got super into it one summer. She was much better at it than I was, but I think just the fact that they were on fire would like shock people into thinking I was better at it than I was if I didn't catch the whole place on fire first.
How did you get into that? That's very specific.
I know. I live in I grew up in a weird little like hippie town where people were always doing just like performative stuff like that. And so we just like saw people doing it one day and we're like, wow, how do you do that? And people were just kind of, so we ended up learning. And
they're
our
like, here's style, here's fire, play with it.
Literally, exactly. Cool. They were like, yeah, fun, here, have this. What can go wrong? Lots of things went wrong.
Mark, what about you?
Wow, I would have to go all the way back to my high school years when I tried to form a synth pop band with a friend who played drums. It was me playing synthesizer and him playing drums. No vocals, nothing else. And I don't know, maybe I could get the band back together and play some of those old tunes.
I'm seeing I think several of you guys could form a super group with like fire dancing, tin whistle. I mean, really, I'm not sure how your talent fits into that, but.
Help us get all our equipment for really cheap.
Yeah, I could do costume. I feel like I can make like computer noises. Is that?
Necessary.
And when Taylor accidentally sets something on fire, Becky will distract everyone.
Great. They know me so well.
This is a great plan. All right, our next question, and I will preface this with a very important caveat. If talent wasn't an issue, which musical or play would you most want to be in, or which role, if you want to get that specific? And this is obviously in honor of Becky's book. So because of that, Becky, I'll have you start.
Oh, absolutely. Eponine from Les Mis.
Knew it right away.
I've known that for my whole life. Yeah.
All right. That's great. Mark, what about you?
You know, when I was way back in elementary school, I tried out for Godspell at the school, and I didn't make the cut. So this is my chance to go back and right that wrong and get a good, juicy role in Godspell.
Got to go for Jesus. That's the...
Why not? Well, let's go straight to the...
Go big. Go big. Taylor, what about you?
In ninth grade, I was Sarah Crewe in A Little Princess, and it was like a vicious, bloody battle for the lead role between a lot of very petty 14-year-old girls, and I think I would probably reprise the role just to upset all of them again.
Little Princess is pretty, you know, what do they call it? Like those books are called like Orphan Corps. Like there's a whole thing about like obsessed with books where there's orphans. Like I was totally.
Oh yeah.
100%. Like Secret Garden, etc. All right, Anne-Marie, what about you?
Okay, I'm going to go back to the fact that you said talent is not the issue, because I want to emphasize that I am not this good of an Irish dancer, but I am bi-gender. I live half my life as a girl, half my life as a guy. So I would like to alternate playing the guy and girl leads in Riverdance.
Whoa! Nice. That's awesome. Yes. I would love to see that. How, I don't know how we can make that happen, but keep practicing.
It has to be, it would have to be in the world where I started when I was three instead of starting as a teen.
That is such a great answer. Julie, what about you?
I have so many answers to this question. It's actually unfair. So I narrowed it down to three. I'm sorry that it's three answers. Okay, my first answer is, I think it's called A Little Music. Whatever the musical is with Send in the Clowns, because that's like my... That's my, like, I'm pounding like my fist on the bed, crying myself to sleep. And then also kind of like Tehlor, except that the role was stolen from me, because as a fat kid in high school, I was constantly like cast as like the grandmother or like the good matriarch figure. And all I wanted was to be Miss Hannigan and Annie. Like, if ever a role was created for me, it was Miss Hannigan. And I lost out on Miss Hannigan. I'm still very bitter about that. Not that you can tell. And then the other thing is that I have a dream to create my own version of Guys and Dolls, but to call it Guys and Dolly. And all the guys dress up as Guy Fieri and all the girls dress up as Dolly Parton. Or all the dolls. And I just would love to see that like happen at like a High School Musical level. So I would start on that if anyone would fund it.
Hey, that's what GoFundMe is for, Julie. Hello. Right. Let's get it started.
I thought it was for the healthcare system.
Yeah. This is more important. This is more important. Wow. That picture is going to stay with me for a long time. All right. Last lightning round question, also inspired by Miss Meteor. So Lita in Miss Meteor, she has named several cactus plants, which she visits frequently and regards as friends. So for y'all, what is the most unusual thing you've ever named? So obviously not people. And if you have to say a pet, that's fine, but I'm hoping for, you know, something a little weirder, perhaps. So who am I gonna start with? Does anyone wanna start? And I'll call on somebody else. You can think about it.
I'm thinking.
Like, I remember what I named, but I don't remember what I named it. Does that count?
Sure.
I had a, like, I was a weird goth kid, you guys. I had like a bird skull that I found on a walk, and it was on this like little dish on top of my bookshelf, and I named it something, because I was a theater kid too, so I was like very Hamlet about it. Like, I talked to it. Because I always had like a big audience. I was always doing something performative and weird. So yeah, bird soul.
Nice. That's pretty good. That's pretty good. Becky, did you have anything?
Yeah. So back in my 20s, when I was just starting to get a handful of like little gray or white hairs like every once in a while, and it was a rare enough occasion that I would name every single one of them after the person who I felt caused it. So
that's a good one.
I love that.
Yeah, it's a great idea until you walk around like with a part of your body named after like Republican politicians, like a terrible boss. Like, but, yeah.
That is so good. That's so good. Anne-Marie, what about you?
Okay, I too don't remember what I named it, but I'm thinking of a printer at a place where I worked, a very temperamental printer, and I would like sweet talk this printer to try to get it to like print whatever like the customer wanted printed. So I would just be like, "You're so pretty," like just romancing this printer whose name I don't even remember. I'm so sorry, printer.
After all, you mean that much to you. That's great. Mark, what about you?
Well, this is kind of cheating. It's not quite a name, but I started doing YouTube videos years ago that are like instructional art videos, how to draw stuff. And for whatever reason, I started to refer to this black colored pencil, which is a Prismacolor. I started to call it my trusty black Prismacolor. And then I had this white gouache, which is just an opaque paint. And this became my beloved white gouache. And so these two things, this is trusty and this is beloved, and I can never flip them around. That's maybe the closest I've got.
I'm just picturing them as like animated characters on your YouTube channel that like pop up. All right, Julie, we're going to go out with you.
All right.
What you got?
I was the kid in high school that stole everything. And I mean, like, yeah, like stealing sunglasses from like Hot Topic, but also like stealing forks and silverware and like bowls from restaurants or stop signs or like street cones, things like that. So in high school, I was in yearbook, and actually even my chair in yearbook was stolen. It was like the backseat of someone's van that I just found on the side of the road, and I made it like my office chair. For my yearbook desk. One of my street cones, what became like the yearbook mascot, and we would like what the yearbook cone was, but we always like decorated it for the season, and it had a name, but again, it must have been a very like unmemorable name, but it definitely had a name.
Great, that's great. Well, thank you guys for sharing all of these answers, but also thank you for sharing with us your books and your stories. And I want to thank everyone watching and tuning in, and just reminding y'all that are watching that you can head to the festival website and you can purchase books and you can purchase festival swag. And if you need an excuse, which you shouldn't ever need an excuse to get a book, but if you do, just know that it helps out the festival. So again, thanks to all of our amazing writers. This was such a blast. And I'm gonna think about that guys and doll dolly. We're going out on.
So it could even be like a themed birthday party.
All right, well, thanks y'all. Good to see you. Bye.
Bye. Bye.